Well, it is a great pleasure to introduce to you Siang Tan, who was raised in Singapore, and then at a great sacrifice, because he was given full scholarships in Singapore, made the choice to go to Canada, to McGill University, got his PhD there, very bright in his field of study of pain. He's actually written a book called Managing Chronic Pain. Well, gosh, he's written so many books, I never keep up. It seems like one a month. But he has done one that I especially want to stress and urge you to look for in the bookstore, called Disciplines of the Holy Spirit, thinking about classical disciplines of the spiritual life and how that fits in, particularly the charismatic renewal and that life under the power and life and goodness of the Holy Spirit can lead us forward in grace. Dr. Tan teaches at Fuller Theological Seminary's School of Psychology. I think he directs the PsyD program still. But I met him particularly there too, but particularly in the church where he is senior pastor that has 5 congregations. I remember Mandarin. We did one service in Mandarin. We did one in Cantonese, yes, and English. I don't know what the other 2 congregations do. English. Need 3 English, you know, to help us. Sometimes we need 3 services for one of the Cantonese. Now, Siang Yang will be speaking to you for about 30 minutes, but I want you to know he will get 90 minutes worth of material into that 30 minutes, because Siang Yang talks fast. So I want to encourage you to take notes fast. Siang Yang, welcome him.
I can't see any of you from here. Have you all gone home? All right, still there, good. I watched a rehearsal of this, is that me? Raccoon? No. I had raccoons in my attic over a year ago, and I still dream about them sometimes. It's exactly that kind of sound. I watched a rehearsal of this drama a couple of days ago, and I will not be making many more comments about it except to say that the woman in this play represented the Holy Spirit, speaking to Jed as he struggled within himself how to handle an abusive father. And as we live life in the reality of life itself, we will face all kinds of struggles and all kinds of trials and tribulations. And we have a choice whether we yield to the Holy Spirit or we go our own way. I want to share with you a few more thoughts about that today, this evening, as I share with you a message based on chapter 5 of Dallas' book, The Divine Conspiracy, on the righteousness of the kingdom heart, beyond the goodness of scribes and Pharisees. And more specifically, as I talk to you about the kingdom heart of agape love in the Holy Spirit. Let us pray before we look into the Word of God. Thank you, Father, for being with us. You have blessed this conference in so many deep and sweet ways already. Many of us are tired at this point, but I ask in the name of Jesus that you, Spirit of God, will come now and speak to us through the Bible, the Word of God, and come and touch us, come and transform us from inside out. Come and change us in our hearts, that we'll become more and more like Jesus, and Jesus will be able to become more and more himself in and through us. We wait upon you. We ask you to speak to us the words of eternal life. And we will not only listen to you, Lord, but by the power of the Spirit and by your grace, we will obey and walk in your ways, because they are the best ways. Protect us. Touch us tonight in a way that will deeply and greatly glorify you. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you have your book with you, the Renovaré book, some of you have lost it a few times already, but on page 64, this is actually a shortened version of the outline that I sent in. I want to share with you a few things just quickly. Dallas Willard wrote the book, so he would probably be better able to share with you some of these points, but I think it's worth repeating some of them. I want to make just a few of them in passing, and then I want to spend most of my time talking about the Holy Spirit and how He is the one who empowers us and enables us to have the kind of agape love heart that is at the very root of true righteousness that goes beyond the goodness of the scribes and the Pharisees. First thing I want to say, and it's in your outline there, is about the brilliance of Jesus. And that the Sermon on the Mount, or the Discourse on the Hill, that's recorded for us in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, we should read as a sermon or talk, as one unified discourse. And then the sequential order in the discourse must also be respected. A lot of that is covered in his book, so I will not say anything more about that. But I want to pause for a moment or two to make a comment or two about the brilliance of Jesus. I think that Dallas makes a very good point in his book that the majority of people, including many Christians like you and me, tend to look at Jesus Christ as a very nice person. We think of him as nice, as compassionate. Some of us from Sunday school days still think of him as Jesus Christ, meek and mild. And we forget that Jesus Christ is the most brilliant person that you can ever meet. And the Bible is the most brilliant book that you can ever read. Whatever Jesus teaches us is eternal truth. He alone has the words of eternal life that will last forever. Everything else will pass away, but His word will not pass away. So I trust that throughout this whole Renovaré conference, you and I, by the grace of God, will be empowered to see how wise and how smart, in a good sense of that word, and how brilliant Jesus is. And will come to have a deeper, much deeper respect for Him, and beyond that, a true worship of Him and His Word. There's nothing like the Bible, the inspired Word of God, and the teachings of Jesus. I've tried to understand as much as I possibly can, both as a pastor as well as a psychologist and professor, the world in which we live. We read about postmodernism and so on. I don't want to sidetrack and talk too much about that, except to say this. You read about Deepak Chopra. You read about the Celestine prophecy. You read about all kinds of writings that are on bestseller lists in the bookstores. People are paying for these books and reading them and taking it all in, because there's a great and significant hunger in our world today for spiritual reality, for something more that goes beyond the materialistic and the material. Hearts are hungry for true spiritual reality. But all these gurus and all these books out there cannot even come near to the master teacher himself, the brilliance of Jesus and the brilliance of the Word of God. We Christians must be touched afresh by the anointing of the Spirit of God to go forth with winsome boldness to share eternal truth that will result in eternal life when obeyed and followed. There's nothing like Jesus and His words. And so today I want to share with you a few more thoughts about that. Now, there's a Greek word there that's difficult to pronounce. I'm going to give it a try anyways. I want you to know that I do not know Greek, unlike Dallas, who knows Greek inside out. Greek still sounds like Greek to me. I do not know Hebrew. But this word in Greek, dikaiosune, is a Greek word that's been translated in the Bible with different English words, but basically with the word righteousness. And Dallas writes in his book, The Divine Conspiracy, that this is the inner life of the soul. Sorry, it is the inner life of the soul that we must aim to transform. And then behavior will naturally and easily follow, but not the reverse. And a special term is used in the New Testament to mark the character of the inner life when it is as it should be. And again, this is the term of the Greek word, dikaiosune. Jesus' account of dikaiosune, or of being a really good person, is given in Matthew 5, verses 20 to 48. I don't have time to read that whole text. The best translation of dikaiosune would be a paraphrase, something like what that is about a person that makes him or her really right or good. For short, we might say true inner goodness. And that's what we want to talk about tonight. As we look at the Sermon on the Mount carefully, we have to realize that it's not a list of legalistic requirements. And Jesus is trying to paint for us the picture of life as a kingdom person, as a disciple of Christ who follows Jesus. And he actually is trying to point out to us, as I've written in my book, The Disciplines of the Holy Spirit, that I co-authored with Doug Gregg. Doug, you're here somewhere. Doug, where are you? Can you just stand up? I just want to welcome you. Doug Gregg's my co-author. Why don't you give him a hand, okay, Doug? Thank you. As we wrote in the book, the heart of the matter is the matter of the heart. And the heart of the matter here in this text in Matthew 5 is a matter of the heart. We need to be changed from inside out. It's not a matter of the behavioral things that are manifested outside, although those are important. They must flow out of an inner heart of agape love. And so this inner goodness that dikaiosune is all about has to do with love. And I want to talk a little bit more about love tonight. To complete the picture of the kingdom heart about agape love, Dallas writes the following. Love does not illustrate. It simply is the goodness beyond the goodness of scribes and Pharisees. And all the illustrations he has given in the various situations discussed in Matthew 5, 20 to 48 are illustrations of it. And then Dallas goes on and talks about 1 Corinthians 13. Let me just paraphrase that in my own words. You know, if you turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and I've read this passage many, many times as I've conducted weddings over the years as a pastor. Just recently, I did another wedding for a couple in our church. And if you read 1 Corinthians 13, which is a favorite passage of Scripture that couples often select to read or to be read at weddings, you will find that if you read the text carefully, and that's the whole point, we don't read our Bibles carefully enough. And then when we do, we don't pay much attention to it. We must go beyond being hearers of the word to being doers of the word by the grace of God and the power of the Spirit, not by our own self-effort. But if you look at 1 Corinthians 13 carefully, you will find that Paul there tells us that love is patient. Love is kind. Love is free of jealousy and arrogance. Love is not rude or self-seeking. Love is not easily angered. Love does not keep a record of wrongs. Love takes no joy in things that are wrong, but instead in what is true. It always protects, always accepts, always hopes, and endures everything. It never quits. Did you notice that? 1 Corinthians 13 says, love is all these things. It doesn't say, you must try to love like that. I've always believed that. And when Dallas explicated on this and explained this in his book, I was really glad to see that he and I agreed on this point. Or at least that I agreed with him. See, in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 1, we read that we are to pursue love. And I'm going to quote Dallas here. As we catch love, as we pursue love, as we move in the very environment and the very context of love, as we catch love, we then find that these things are, after all, actually being done by us. These things, these godly actions and behaviors, are the result of dwelling in love. We have become the kind of person who is patient, kind, free of jealousy, and so on. See, Paul, in other words, is telling us that love is like that. Love does these things. You and I, in our own human weakness, No matter how much self-effort we try to engage in, we cannot love like this. It is impossible to love in this agape, agapao way. Only God is like this, because God is love. And so the kingdom heart of agape love is something that the Lord wants to form within us, and He wants to produce in and through us. But that can only happen when we continue to walk in the very context and environment of love Himself. And I want to share with you a few biblical texts that are in your outline on page 65. Let me just talk about that briefly. There are at least five of them, and I have a few others I'll share as we go along. First of all, in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8, we read that whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. One of the simplest definitions of God and His character and His being is that God is love personified. God is love Himself. And if we know God, we will know love, and we will love one another, as well as that we will love God Himself. So God is love. As we walk with God, as we are centered in God, that love will continue to flow in and through us. The second passage is from Galatians chapter 5 in verses 22 and 23. And here the Bible is even more explicit. It tells us here, but the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, is love, and joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Some theologians believe that the primary teaching of Galatians 5, 22 and 23 about the fruit of the Spirit is about agape love. You have to notice here in the English translation, which I believe is accurate from the original Greek there, is that the fruit of the Spirit is love. It's singular, not plural. See? The fruit of the Spirit is love. And in joy and peace and patience and kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control are aspects of this love that are manifested. The fruit of the Holy Spirit is love. And so for the kingdom heart of agape love to be manifested in our lives, the Spirit's work is crucial. It is the fruit of the Holy Spirit. We cannot manufacture fruit. We cannot try to drum up love. And many of us who are Christians have this wrong idea that love is synonymous with liking. Many of us think that to love someone means to like someone. And I've heard many people tell me in my counseling experience, my pastoral visitation, in my dialogue with people, that, well, I cannot love this person, Siang Yang. And by the way, that's how you pronounce my first name, and Richard got it right. It sounds like Yang Yang. And you put an S in front, you get Siang. Siang Yang Tan, that's my name, okay? So forget about Dr. Tan, forget about Tan, just call me Siang Yang, all right? Now, what has that got to do with love? If you really love me, you'll call me Siang Yang. All right. People have told me, Siang Yang, I cannot love this person. I hate him. I don't like this person. This person turns me off. I have no good, positive feelings for this person. Well, agape love is not primarily about positive feelings toward people. And I'm so glad that Jesus never commanded us to like one another. He told us to love one another. And in the power of the Holy Spirit, the impossible becomes possible. By faith, we yield ourselves to Him. We turn to Him. We surrender to Him. We submit to Him and ask for His full control of our lives to fill us with His presence and His power and His love. And then we take steps of faith to go out and do loving things to people, even if we don't like them. And then agape love will begin to be manifested. And the paradoxical thing is that when you begin to love people that you don't like, eventually, very often, you end up not just loving them, but also liking them. Don't wait until you like someone to love someone. Let the Spirit of God love people through you, and liking will follow. And even if it doesn't follow, you can still love those that you don't particularly like. So the fruit of the Spirit then is love. This agape love is something that the Holy Spirit produces. Therefore, from Galatians chapter 5, we come to the conclusion that we must understand much more deeply and accurately the ministry and the person of the Holy Spirit in our lives. The third passage is from Romans chapter 5 and verse 5. I spent 3.5 years in my church recently preaching through the book of Romans. Went from Romans 1 to Romans chapter 16. But I will not take 3.5 years now to go through Romans 5:5. I'll take 1 or 2 minutes. Listen carefully. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out His love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom He has given us. You see, the Holy Spirit is crucial, central, in this whole kingdom life that we're talking about. We must not just state that as a fact. We must not just say, yes, the Holy Spirit is important. We have to understand how to yield to His presence and to His power. Because without His presence and His power, we cannot live the kingdom life. It is an impossible life that Jesus has called us to live. And if you're not careful, we will take the teachings of Jesus and we'll see His brilliance and we'll see all the stuff in the Bible and we'll take them seriously and we'll try to obey in our self-effort and we'll fail and fail and fail again. And then we'll close the book, throw it out and say, it ain't gonna work. It doesn't work. This is the impossible life. And if you tell me that, you know what I'll tell you? You're right. It is an impossible life. It takes the God of the impossible, God who alone can do the impossible, to enable us and empower us by His Holy Spirit to live this life. So again, God pours His love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. He's the one who enables us to experience this pouring in of God's love, this embracing of the love of God. And Jim Smith has written a book on that called Embracing the Love of God that I highly recommend for your reading. The Holy Spirit whom He has given to us. Day by day, if you and I are struggling to experience the reality of God's love for us, we need only to come and very humbly say and pray, Spirit of God, I need You. Fill me. Enable me to experience the love of God. Let me taste and see that the Lord is good. But You have got to do it. Because if You don't, I'm finished. I cannot. But You can. And come and ask for the Spirit of God to fill us and for God to pour His love into our hearts day by day by the Holy Spirit. And Jesus talks about something very similar in John 15:5 as I go to the fourth text there on page 65. I am the vine, says Jesus here. You are the branches. Those who abide in Me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from Me, you can do nothing. See, we need to abide, to stay in, to remain in, to continue to be centered in Christ, to be in communion with Him, to be in union with Him. And it's the Holy Spirit who makes that possible. And we do that as we practice the spiritual disciplines and as we practice the presence of God moment by moment in yielding to Him. And then Paul says in 2 Corinthians 3:18, the fifth text there, and we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into His likeness with ever-increasing glory which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. And it's a process of gradual but deeper and deeper transformation and sanctification as the agape heart of the Lord Himself is formed and is manifested in and through our lives by the Spirit of God. Now, I've talked about being filled with the Spirit of God. If you look at the third section there on page 65, you will find that there is a section there on disciplines of the Holy Spirit. That's the title of the book that Doug Gregg and I wrote. And in Ephesians 5:18, we read a verse that's very important. I want to share that verse with you now. Well, the first part of the verse we often don't read. But Paul there tells us, do not be drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. And those of you again who know Greek will know that that tense there is a present continuous tense of the Greek. Be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. It's not a once and for all event. It is a continuous filling of the Spirit that we need day by day, moment by moment. Paul says, be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. That's the only way that you're going to know kingdom life and live out kingdom life. And so we wrote this book called Disciplines of the Holy Spirit because there has been a tendency in Christian circles today to have antagonistic camps within evangelical circles, so to speak. And one of the things that I'm very thankful to God for with regard to Renovaré is that we have these streams of spirituality that we are allowing to be represented equally and fully. We started with 5 streams. Then Richard wrote a book, and it's now 6 streams. And when he was writing the book and he gave me a phone call, he was thinking of 7 streams, but I think he ran out of time, so he stopped at 6. I don't know. Whether it's 5 or 6 or 7, there are various streams of Christian spirituality based solidly on the Word of God that are all equally valid. We must stop this nonsense about pitting the contemplative stream of spirituality against the charismatic stream of spirituality. We must stop this silliness of pitting the evangelical stream against the social concerns or social action stream or the holiness stream. All these streams of spirituality are needed by the body of Christ. And this book, when we talk about the disciplines of the Holy Spirit, we have made a very concerted attempt, by the grace of God, I believe, to integrate particularly the contemplative evangelical streams that emphasize quiet and solitude and prayer and meditation on the Word of God with the charismatic stream of the empowerment of the Spirit of God and the giftings of the Spirit of God, and especially the fruit of this Holy Spirit, chief of which, here again, is agape love. And so we have written about these disciplines in that context. Otherwise, I think you all are aware, and Richard has written the classic, Celebration of Discipline, and Dallas followed up with The Spirit of the Disciplines. Otherwise, the disciplines can be legalisms. They can be millstones around your neck. If I pray, God will bless me. If I read 5 chapters of the Bible, God will bless me. That is not the idea behind the disciplines. The disciplines instead are a means of response to God's amazingly loving and kind and gracious invitation to intimacy with Him. We pray not so that we can earn God's blessing. Remember, grace cannot be earned. You know, the other day I was just thinking about this and I came up with this little punning phrase. Pardon me for punning, but you can't earn. You turn and learn. You can't earn grace, but by grace you turn to Jesus and you learn from Him by the power of His Holy Spirit. So these disciplines then are means to an end. The end is to know God intimately and to be empowered by His Spirit so that we can live the kingdom life. You know, one of the things that I deeply, deeply respect and appreciate about Dallas is his I don't even know how to describe it. Just the peace that he exudes and the contentment inside and the grace of God that's there. And you remember, I think it was either today or yesterday, maybe it was today, early in the afternoon in his earlier session, when he said that, I don't particularly look for power. If God gives me power, that's fine, but I don't look for it. I appreciate that attitude. Because one of the dangers about the charismatic stream, if you're not careful, is that it becomes a charismatic stream. See? And all we look for is power, power, power. And we go from one conference to another to get zapped and to fall down and to have all these other manifestations as if this is what kingdom life is all about. I sure hope that you get up after you fall down and go out into the world and be what Jesus has called you to be. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I know there are charismatics. How many of you are charismatics? Pentecostals, wave your hand. Hallelujah. Would you do hallelujah with me? Hallelujah. Do this. One more time. Hallelujah. Both hands. Okay. Baptist, you ready? Hallelujah. Okay, never mind. I'm not trying to make fun of this. We did this the other day at a church. I don't want you to misunderstand me. I go to those meetings. I attend revival meetings. I go to conferences on prophecy and on spiritual warfare and on apostolic anointing. I attend all those things. And I've been blessed by them. One of my closest friends in our church circles has said that the evangelical disease or dysfunction or disorder of our day is attending conferences. We go from one conference to another, feverishly trying to get an experience when God is already there speaking to us in His still small voice by His Spirit. Sometimes I think that you and I will grow much deeper into Jesus Christ if we spend days alone with Him at home rather than going on another conference. Besides, you'll be broke soon. And this friend of mine had some words of wisdom to share. He says, you know, I think one of the best ways to overcome this evangelical disease or disorder or dysfunction is to make sure that after you attend a conference, you have digested what you've learned in the conference, and the Holy Spirit has helped you to apply the truth into your life so that you're obeying the words of Jesus, not just listening, building your life on rock. Then you go to the next conference. Otherwise, it may be better for you and your spiritual life, as well as for your pocketbook, not to attend the next conference. Well, I'm glad you are here. This is the one conference you should attend. Now, the disciplines of the Holy Spirit, nothing new here, but Doug, Greg, and I put them together under three categories. First of all, drawing near to God. It always must begin there, intimacy with God. This is what it's all about. Otherwise, it'll be legalism. Disciplines of solitude. They include solitude and silence, listening and guidance, prayer and intercession, Bible study and meditation, and then yielding to God, disciplines of surrender, repentance and confession, yielding and submission, fasting, worship. I don't have time to expound on each of these. And finally, reaching out to others, disciplines of service, fellowship with one another, simplicity of life that others may be blessed, service and witness. In my workshop today on building your life on rock, somebody asked me a question about the danger of the spiritual disciplines being individualistic. I think there's a real danger, but you notice that a third of the disciplines here, at least a third section, has to do with reaching out to others, disciplines of service. And Richard Foster has already made it very clear in his classic book, Celebration of Discipline, that the disciplines are both individual as well as corporate. Life in the kingdom involves life with the triune God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, who is love himself. And in love, he will move us out to love our neighbor as ourselves. There is no place in true, mere Christianity for complete individualism. That is the very antithesis, actually, of the gospel. And so those disciplines help us. They are means to an end. And the Holy Spirit uses these disciplines to empower us and to fill us with His very presence. But again, based on Ephesians 5 and verse 18, day by day, every morning when we get up, one of the first prayers that you and I need to pray is to come before God and say, God, thank you for this day. I give my life to you. I yield myself to you. Cleanse me from sin. And Holy Spirit of God, fill me. Fill me afresh. And throughout the day, to pray that the Spirit of God will continue to fill us, because His presence and His power are essential for kingdom life and kingdom ministry. Now, in conclusion, I want to share with you a couple of quotations. Some of them are in your book, some of them are not. I especially want to read a couple of excerpts from Sandra Wilson's book. Sandra Wilson is here. She's a Christian psychologist who's been a good friend of mine for several years. She's written a book called Into Abba's Arms. It has to do, again, with knowing the intimate love of God. Because without that love, again, kingdom life cannot flow. This is what she says in a couple of excerpts as she had her own times of solitude and prayer with the Lord. And the Lord spoke to her in a special kind of a sense in her heart as she journaled. And I would like to read this for you because I believe this will bless your heart. Grace to you and peace are my gifts to you and all my children. You have been seeking grace, a favored status from people, believing it will bring peace. It never does. Only entering more and more deeply into the reality of my grace will bring the genuine peace of heart you are dying for. I already died for it. And I rose so that you would know it's true. And I have the power to make it true for you. Hear me, believe me, learn to rest in the peace of my grace. As you let me love you and tell you of my love, you'll be strengthened in your inner person. You can't be spiritually strong without deeply knowing that I love you. You, not just the world, but you. Another excerpt, my dear child. Your sorrow, anguish, and tears are the process and the proof that I'm answering your prayer. Rest in me. Today, let me hold you quietly in my love and presence. I am your Father. Where else would you go when you're hurt and weary, but home, where you belong, here in my presence? Learn to listen for my voice in the stillness and quietness of your heart. Learn to let my presence nurture and fill you. Then you will cease striving for what never fulfills its promise to satisfy. Come home where you belong fully and freely, where you can be loved fully and freely, where you can find rest fully and freely, forever. Yes, you can tell your brothers and sisters too, for I want them to come home where they belong. Keep doing your part. Present your body and mind and heart to me each day, each moment, and I will keep doing my part. I love you more than you can know. And in conclusion, there are a couple of quotations that I want to read, and I want to pray with you and for you as we end. Ron Sider, as you know, is a well-known evangelical social action, social concern activist. He was at my church and a number of churches, the first evangelical churches in the LA area just a few weeks ago. In his book, Living Like Jesus, he writes the following kind of fantasy scenario. Only God knows what the Archangel Gabriel will see as he watches the 21st century unfold. But you and I can dream and pray and work. Gabriel is astonished at the resulting beauty and goodness. But even more, he marvels at the simplicity of the original plans. All it takes to spread the gospel, renew the family, and reform society is a small band of genuine Christians as dedicated to Christ as the first 120. And as Gabriel watches their impact, he's astonished to realize that the genuine Christians are still just a minority of those who claim the name. That minority, however, has an awesome power. And the reason is simple. Day by day, they look into the face of Jesus Christ and they whisper quietly, Lord, there is nothing I want as much as to be more like you. If you give me the power of the Holy Spirit implied, I'll do whatever you want me to do with my life. If day by day you and I pray this prayer, the agape heart of kingdom life and love will grow within us and transform us from inside out. Lord, there's nothing I want as much as to be more like you. If you give me the power, I'll do whatever you want me to do with my life. And then I'll conclude with Richard's quotation from his book on prayer that I love very, very much. And this is something that Richard actually experienced. He didn't just write about. God has graciously allowed me to catch a glimpse into his heart, and I want to share with you what I have seen. Today, the heart of God is an open wound of love. He aches over our distance and preoccupation. He mourns that we do not draw near to him. He grieves that we have forgotten him. He weeps over our obsession with muchness and manyness. He longs for our presence. And he's inviting you and me to come home to where we belong, to come home to that for which we were created. His arms are stretched out wide to receive us. His heart is enlarged to take us in. For too long, we've been in a far country, a country of noise and hurry and crowds, a country of climb and push and shove, a country of frustration and fear and intimidation. And he welcomes us home, home to serenity and peace and joy, home to friendship and fellowship and openness, home to intimacy and acceptance and affirmation. The key to this home, this heart of God, is prayer. And I think as Jim Smith said in his workshop yesterday, all of us who are Christians are charismatic. You cannot be a Christian without being charismatic. In what sense? Not in the sense of being Pentecostal or charismatic in that sense, but being charismatic in the sense that we are people who realize that we need the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. And we come and yield ourselves to him and pray for him to fill us day by day. And in that context, kingdom life will flow and you and I will be transformed from inside out. Let us pray. We thank you, O Lord, for your presence here tonight. And despite our tiredness, I pray now in the name of Jesus, that Spirit of God, you will so graciously and mercifully come and fill each one of us to overflowing. We need you. We come to you. We pray that you'll fill us with your presence and the love of God so that we can become kingdom people whose hearts have been transformed from inside out by agape love. And you'll send us forth from this place to love our neighbor and the world out there, especially those who are lost, as much as we love ourselves. And you enable us to love you, Lord, more and more each day. Thank you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.